a YM initiative to profile our heroes of change. As the people we believe are pushing the industry forward in academia and everywhere to make sure the industry survives. Mm-hmm. And there's no way we can go around it without getting to you. Personally, I know you to have been, in fact, to be a very huge encouragement for the YM. But not most everybody knows that. And if I should talk about you personally, there's so many things I could say. But the simple question is, who is Professor Kumar?
Well, Professor Kumar is a professor of environmental hydrogeology and geophysics. He has been at the University of Mines and Technology for the past 31 years. He came in at the then UST School of Mines in 1985 as a national service person. And because Professor Kuma likes teaching and engaging people in geology, he decided to stay here and to see out his term. So little by little, step by step, he did his master's, then his PhD, and continued to do what is his passion until now he's the vice chancellor of the University of Mines and Technology. So in a nutshell, that is also coming for you.
Professor, geology. Was it by accident?
I would say no, because I remember when I was a kid, about maybe 9 or 10 years, a cousin of mine was in the secondary school at the time, and he was reading geography. He brought the Atlas map, I remember very well, to the house, and I, as a young boy, was just looking at the pictures. But what struck me at the time was the boundary between Africa as the west coast and the east coast of South America. So I tried to see how it would fit, and then I started trying to see how all the continents would get together. So I believe that interest was something which I carried along until I, you know, finished my A-levels. And thankfully I met, at the time, my senior at Mauli School, who had, you know, gone to Legon to read geology. And then he started telling me about the, you know, interesting things about studying geology. So when the time came to buy forms, geology was one of the subjects I chose. So I wouldn't say it was by accident, even though that was not the first choice. You know, it was always something I wished I would do. And I would say that if I'm given the chance again, I would choose geology as the first choice for study.
In fact, you're undoubtedly one of the very successful people in academia. What has really been your strength?
Well, like I told you, I like to share knowledge, and I also like to do it very well. If I'm doing things very well, it's part of me. If I know I cannot do something, I don't take it as a project to do. So anything that I accept to do, I want to do it to the best of my ability. So I'll say that is where I would say I draw my strength from, and I believe that's what has carried me up until now.
you really want to share some of the most important highlights? I mean, obviously, being a VC is one of the highlights.
Well, I think all things started getting together for good when I actually became a Christian. And so I will say that if one wants to look at Professor Puma as a successful academician, then the secret is that he became a Christian at a certain point in time, a young man. And like I said, I always want to do things as best as I can. So I also try to be the best Christian as I can. And I believe God, you know, looking at our hearts, you know, decided that this young man gets some rubbing of his grace upon his life, and that's what has carried me to where I am, because I have, you know, colleagues who I believe can equally be in this position. But for me to be here one at a time, you know, for a period, I think it is the doing of the Lord, and he is the one who gives the glory.
Man, there's this thing I've always been thinking. Looking back, say 20 years ago, and having the opportunity then, probably as Mr. Puma, going all the way, coming all the way now, where you probably determine more or less the academic standard. What would you say for professionalism? Has things changed? Are we going down, coming up, or we are there? Can we comfortably say that?
Well, I would say that in this world, there must always be improvement or development. And so I would say that we are trying to improve on the standards at every point in time. And so I would say the university, as it has metamorphosed from the School of Mines days through to the Western University College, and now to be a full-fledged university, what it has given us is the opportunity and the ability to take decisions of our own. And from the tutelage that we had from KMUST, and then now be on our own, it has given us the impetus to now chart a course which we think will, at the end of the day, improve things in the way we see it. And so we are trying to chart that course. And that's the reason why, as we speak, we are the best public funded university in Ghana. Many people, you know, look up to the older universities. Yes, they are there. But we have certain facts which we, you know, when we put them on the table, it is clear to everybody to see. It's clear for everybody to see. We have the best teacher, the student-teacher ratio in science and engineering in the country, exactly as NCT, National Accreditation Board, we want it to be. We have a very strong quality assurance system, which I believe is second to none. And so you will not see lecturers absenting themselves and maybe asking teaching assistants to teach. It doesn't happen in this. Our programs are practically oriented so that we wedge practical field trips into theory so that our students are all round when they come out. And industries that find our students as employees, they have the testimonies comparing them to the other graduates. And it will surprise you to note that we have very competitive fees. Indeed, our fees are lower than the others. But our numbers are small. And if you work the economics of scale, we should be charging the higher fees.
Yeah, ideally.
But, you know, just in April, the Deputy Minister of Education for Tertiary came to the university with His Excellency the President, and he said, for the whole nation to hear, that UMAT is the most compliant university in Ghana, according to National Accreditation Board and National Council for Tertiary Education. And he said the executive secretaries of those two bodies are very impressed about the quality and the standards that are here in UMAT. If that will not make anybody here raise his head and be happy that he is part of an educational system that the minister himself can say to the whole world, then I don't know. Now, if we move maybe a step backwards, our students they are taught to graduate and be able to rub shoulders with any student across the world. And we are saying this based on facts. Our first class students, BSc first class, some of them have gone out to do a straight PhD in one of the best research universities in the world. They went to Australia, and one of them received 2 awards from his PhD, and I am told it is unprecedented in the history of that university for one student or candidate to take 2 awards. It has not happened before.
No, it doesn't happen.
And as though it were a fluke, the runner-up to one of the awards was also an alumnus of this university, and a lady. So you can see the standards, yeah. And they went from BSc straight to PhD, and they did it within schedule. In fact, as we speak, 10 of those fine graduates have graduated with their PhD, and they are back here to help strengthen our staff. That is one. Then we have these Quarry Life Awards, which Gassem, their mother company, Heidelberg Cement, all over the world, they ran a competition. And last year, we also took part in the competition. And the competition is for scientists and engineers, young scientists and engineers in the country, and of course, in all the other countries that, you know, Heidelberg Cement, they operate. And for the national awards, when they were shortlisted, the competitors were shortlisted. The 5, you might have 2 students as part of the 5. And we had PhD holders also among the 5 and among the competitors. And finally, the first person was a 3rd-year geological engineering student. That's the national. And the runner-up, the 2nd position, was a final year mining engineering student, 1st and 2nd, from UMAT. Now tell me. And the first person went to the international award, and according to the citation, he had the largest public vote across the world.
Yes.
And he won the category of innovation and biodiversity. So putting all this together warms our hearts that we are improving on the delivery of academic or the quality of education insofar as higher education is concerned. I know there have been some negative comments in the papers about, you know, the quality of graduates that are churned out. They do not meet, you know, industry. I always tell people when I get them one-on-one that that is not true for UMass graduates. Because the amount of practicals, the laboratory work that we put into our students, and we have simulators that simulate what should happen in industry, when they leave UMass, they are more than able, of course, from a student to a workplace, the person needs some orientation. And you give him 2 weeks maximum, he's already comfortable. So UMass is a unique institution, and I believe we are on the path of getting laurels for this university. Talking about laurels, the European Society of Quality Research is giving an award to this university this year in June. We are being invited to Brussels to receive the award. This adds on and rubs on to the good things that are happening here. And I'm saying this for people who would, you know, be listening, that if you have a young man or a young woman who would want to study engineering, the best place to be is to experience the teaching of the learning environment in UMass. And that's the reason why I chose the University College. After going around, I think that we should mentor their engineering school. Everybody says at Chelsea, their education is unique, is this, is that. But they came to us, people don't understand why they didn't go to other universities but UMass. And the president said it is because of the quality of engineering education in UMass. That is why he thinks that the best place for them to affiliate with for mentorship is the University of Mines and Technology. So
going back a bit, still on the quality of education, I mean, you've done a lot of work in the UK and then Poland as well, and your travels have taken you almost everywhere in the world, but by way of academia. The girl-boy ratio, what are we targeting? What should we be looking at? I mean, back in the days, it was almost 90% to 10%. What
was the I think 1999 thereabouts, we had 420 or so young men.
Less than 10 girls.
And
yeah.
One lady.
Yeah, that was 1995, 1996.
But, of course, we are in mining, we are in engineering, and one would say that the two are, you know, much tilted towards a male-dominated environment.
Yeah.
But we have actually made gender mainstreaming as one of our core principles in admitting, you know, students to this university, because we want to increase the female participation in engineering. And so what we have done is, for example, this year we have sent some of our staff to the girls' schools, exclusively girls' schools, to talk to them about opportunities in this university. And we took along the lady who excelled in Australia with the runner-up award to, you know, talk to the females, you know, a young, let's say 27, 28 year old with a PhD. A female is something they can see as a role model.
Yeah.
But in the university, what we do is that there is a grade which is not the cutoff for the men, which we normally fix for the ladies, we make their admissions more flexible. So that if you are within that band, you get an automatic admission. So you don't, as it were, submit the ladies to the keen competition that we, you know, get the young men to go through. And we have seen from the results that the ladies perform just as well as the young men when they are all exposed to the same environment of teaching and learning. And so, little by little, the female, you know, percentage should improve. We are now around 16%. It's still low, because ideally, we should have between 40-60 and 50-50.
Yes.
That is where we are aiming at. But the number of, you know, girls or young women doing science in the SSS is also an issue. So little by little, as we start going to the SSS institutes, we think we'll be able to pick up, you know, the interest in science so that they can come here to study.
You're very patient. Very, very patient. Super patient person I've ever come across. I mean, some of us have lived that. Back in the days, we were very stubborn and we still handle us. And I remember there was a time you even asked me why I came here and said, my daddy wants me to be here. You only laughed and then that was it. And then there was another time a colleague and I were just sitting down, we were lecturing, not paying attention. You caught our attention and then asked why Aggie should be where they are. Mr. Zuda said he believes God put them there. You just laughed over it. You see, what I'm trying to say is, how did you come by that virtue? Was it something you learned over the years, and is it something you believe professors should have?
Well, obviously, when you have a class load of people from different backgrounds, you should expect that there will be some with extreme, let me call it, behavioral, you know, tendencies, others just normal, and some who may be completely lukewarm. You should have all that mix. And if you want to be a good lecturer, you should be able to capture the attention of all of these people. Because the end point is that you have to teach everybody to pass. You are not there to intimidate and to drive some out. Even though some may not know the reason why they have come, or like you said, the father or the mother said, or the parent said, come to school. You, the lecturer, must make the person aware of the potential in him or her and the fact that where he or she is now, she needs to take something out when she leaves the university. And so I try to get everybody, you know, to get to the point where you'll be able to get something out of the lectures. And so I think somehow also I'll say the fact that I became a Christian is also one of the virtues that I strongly believe has rubbed in into getting those who may be rather very boisterous in class to tone down. You know, I was telling a friend the other day that those who really are not, I have a way of bringing them to order, call them to come and sit in front. And once a while, I'll use them to crack a joke. And by the end of the day, the person will have to mellow because he will not want people to be laughing at him in the head. And then, once he gets that attention, he continues the lectures.
Really, what motivates you?
motivates me is I would want to do everything the way God wants it to be. God says we should be perfect because He's a perfect God. And so I say to people that the day you lose track of heaven, then you should know that the devil has stolen you. And so if that focus is always what you are looking up to, then a lot of times you will do things right because you are not going to lose track of, you know, heaven's march that we are all, I believe, marching towards. It's very easy to be carried away by the things around you, but if your focus is on the Lord, I believe that as much as possible you want to please Him. And that's my motivation.
What would you really say to young professionals in the industry and the students who are being trained to take on the mantles of the industrial business?
I would say, one, we should do our best in every situation. The Bible says that we should work as though we are working for the Lord, not for men. And so when either a student or a professional, you may think your boss is hard or he's not somebody accommodating, but just do what He wants you to do. That is obedience. And be patient. Because things happen little by little, step by step. You may think the people do not notice you or are not aware of who you are. At the end of the day, they are going to sum up all your attributes and say, this person is like this or like that. If you are obedient in school or at work, it will show at the end of the day. And, you know, if you are young, know that there is time for you to just work your way up. Yes, you will have to be ambitious, but take every day at a time and do the best for each day. Then God, our helper, will do the rest. So that is what I'll tell the young men, especially the professionals. Don't be in a hurry to get rich. Because if the Lord blesses you, He will obviously give you wealth. He will not add sorrow to it. So you will be content at the end of the day. But if you rush in life, you can easily get your hands bent. And at the end of the day, in all those riches, with a sick body or crushed prematurely, so where are you taking the riches? But if you take life one day at a time, taking the best or making the best out of each day, always obedient to your boss. Even if he doesn't like you, in his heart he will know that this person is special, and therefore, no matter how much he will want to suppress you, God Himself will have a way of elevating you in due time.
Yeah, probably are not the only stranger in the internet. Back in the days, we took it to be that everything that is happening has happened before. You can overcome it and move on. Where did you get that faith from? Because almost everybody, I don't know, we still talk about it,
Every time we are locked up in doing something, my colleagues and I still talk about it. Look, you are not the only student.
Well, I don't know. One thing I tell my students, maybe you are rephrasing it,
yeah,
because I always remember I tell them that you are not the first,
that is early,
and you will not be the last.
That's it.
People have passed through.
Yeah.
You may see the subject as difficult, but nobody has failed, and you don't want to be the first. So all you have to do is to focus on it, and then you will pass. And you know, you are supposed to encourage the young people or people around you. Like the lecturer can find the means by which you have or you will take away that apprehension of failure from you. Then you are going to study in, I'll say, freedom, and therefore you'll be able to make it. So it's, I'll say, an attribute of getting the best out of people.
Yeah, we really need to have the passion to share knowledge. We need to be meticulous in everything we do. We have to be patient. A good betting we all have to do. And always remember that eyes are watching. As professionals, we need to take a day at a time and do the best for each day. Okay, thanks so much for having us.
Thank you very much.